Hello everyone, there's going to be a new version of the AWS Certified Cloud Practitioner exam on the 19th of September 2023. So I'm recording this basically just about a week or so before that date. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to walk you through the new exam guide. So the exam guide gets published before the actual exam gets released, helps us to understand what are the various different concepts that are going to be required knowledge for the new version of the exam. And there's going to be some changes. So we've changed from the CLF-C01 to the CLF-C02. That's the new version of the exam, which means there's going to be a reasonable amount of changes. I'm going to walk through the exam guide and help you to understand, you know, what it entails if you want to earn this certification, what the prerequisites are, etc. And we'll go through the actual details of the exam guide as well and look at some of the services which are included, and I'll try and highlight the ones that are a bit newer compared to the older version of the exam. So here we are. This is the exam guide for the CLF-C02. So as it mentions here, this exam is intended for individuals who have a knowledge of the cloud independent of a specific job role. The Cloud Practitioner exam, it's not really about being hands-on. Okay, so this is not necessarily for hands-on people. If you're going to be an engineer, a solutions architect, a developer, working in DevOps, etc., then the other certifications are more suitable. If you're a security specialist, for example, then there's the security specialty as well. And then there's the associate and professional levels for those core job roles like solutions architect, SysOps administrator, and developer. Now, the reason that the Cloud Practitioner exam exists is because AWS wanted to have another certification that was for people who maybe they're working in a role that involves cloud, but they're not a hands-on practitioner. They're not building things, they're not developers or architects, but they do need to understand the cloud. So that's who it's intended for. It's for anyone who's going to work with the cloud. And it's going to help you to understand things like the value of the AWS cloud. What are the benefits of using cloud technologies like AWS? You'll need to understand things like the AWS shared responsibility model. Who is responsible for what? There's a responsibility from the provider and also for the customer working on the cloud. And then we've got security best practices, some of the cloud costs and economics, billing practices. So you'll need to understand the various different billing models and how you can save money and where the discounts are and reserving instances, for example, for 1 or 3 years, the various different options you have with regard to cost in the cloud. You also need to understand some of the core services. So even though it isn't a hands-on exam, it's not designed for people who are building on AWS, you do need to understand various different services, quite a lot of them actually, from various different areas like compute, networking, storage, databases, analytics, machine learning, and it goes on further. So you need to be able to identify services for common use cases. So that's the key thing here. You don't need to understand these services at a really deep level like you do in some of the other exams, but you do need to understand what they're used for, when you might use one over another one. Okay, so recommended knowledge. Of course, there's a bit here around what you should understand. We cover all of this in our courses to make sure that you you do learn everything in the course that you're going to need to know for the exam. Of course, it mentions here, out of scope is things like coding and cloud architecture design. Those are more advanced. Troubleshooting, which is obviously a bit more hands-on, as is implementation and load and performance testing. So you're not expected to understand how those different things work or have that kind of practical experience with those different job roles. Now, in terms of exam content, the exam has multiple choice questions and multiple response. There's no sort of hands-on component. Again, it's a very, very theoretically based examination. So you just have to answer questions and they're pretty straightforward in the Cloud Practitioner exam. They're not very complex. If they are scenarios, they're very simple scenarios, not like, for example, the associate or professional level where the scenarios get ever more complicated. One thing to note, there's 65 questions in the exam. As it mentions here, there's 15 unscored questions. So you actually only get tested on 50 questions and you need to get a 70% or 700 out of 1,000 points to pass the exam. You don't know which ones the 15 are, they're just randomly thrown in somewhere and they're more for AWS to do some research Right, let's just skip past some of this. You can read all this. You can find this exam guide easily if you want to read everything. I just want to come down here to the content outline. This is the important thing. Okay, so the exam has these different domains. Okay, the domains are the core knowledge areas for the exam. First one is cloud concepts. Again, these are the sort of core concepts around cloud computing, the value proposition, how it works, etc. Security and compliance, really important to understand how we can implement security in the cloud. You don't have to know how to exactly implement it for this exam, of course, because it's not practical, it's more theory based. But you do need to understand where the different places are that you can apply security, whose responsibility it is, and that sort of thing. And then cloud technology and services, that's where you need to understand the various different services in the cloud, what their use cases are as well. And then lastly, domain four is billing, pricing, and support. It's only 12% of the exam, but you really do need to understand the pricing models, the support plans, etc. Now let's go down so we can see cloud concepts. I will breeze through these fairly quickly. Again, you can read them in detail if you want to. I just want to sort of cover off the sort of high level task statements. So define the benefits of the cloud. Here we have knowledge of the value proposition of the cloud. Things like economies of scale, understanding the benefits of the global infrastructure and the advantages of using high availability, elasticity, and agility, which of course are core benefits of using the cloud. The well-architected framework, you need to know about the well-architected framework. You can read some documentation on the AWS website about this. And really it's more about understanding some of the high level concepts in there. You don't need to become an actual architect. Next, we have understand the benefits and strategies for migration to the cloud. So you need to know some of the different scenarios in which you would actually migrate into the cloud and some of the services that might be used. Next up, we've got understand concepts of cloud economics. So again, things like cost savings of the cloud, you know, when you might want to do things like bring your own licenses in, or you might want to use different licensing strategies. You might want to fix in for certain periods of time so that you can lower your overall costs where you have steady state workloads. Now we're on to domain two. So AWS shared responsibility model is the first one that comes up here. This is about understanding the responsibilities of AWS versus the responsibilities of you as a customer. Next, we have understand cloud security, governance, and compliance. So you've got to understand things like, you know, where you can apply encryption and how you might secure your resources and what services might be used for different things like protecting against distributed denial of service or malware. You need to be able to identify AWS access management capabilities. This is around the AWS single sign-on service and the IAM service identity and access management. Next up, let's come down to identifying components and resources for security. So this is more about the various different services and features of AWS that allow you to implement security in the cloud. Next up, we have domain three, cloud technology and services. You must be able to define methods of deploying and operating in the cloud. So how do you provision? What are the various different services that you can use for provisioning infrastructure and applications into the cloud? What are the different deployment models of the cloud as well? And connectivity options to the cloud, for instance, implementing hybrid models. The next task statement is define the AWS global infrastructure. The global infrastructure are the regions, the availability zones, edge locations, and other components of the AWS platform around the world. You need to be able to identify AWS compute services, so the various different compute services, then it moves on to database services, then network services. So this goes on quite a way. We've then got storage services, and there are a lot of services that you do need to understand for this. The next task statement is identify AWS artificial intelligence and machine learning. Now, last exam revision certainly had machine learning, but AI is a newer addition. So we've got some new services making making an entrance into the exam now around artificial intelligence, which is obviously an area of technology that's exploding in popularity at the moment. So you need to have knowledge of the different AI and ML services, as well as analytics services as well. This one here is a little bit of a sort of catch-all. It says identify services from other in-scope service categories. And so of course, there's lots of different categories on AWS outside of compute and storage and networking and so on, such as databases and application integration. And so they've just thrown those into this one task statement here. And it can include quite a wide variety of services. Okay, let's scroll down. The last domain here, we've got billing, pricing, and support. So as I've mentioned before, you need to understand the different pricing models. You need to know how you can reduce cost, how you're charged as well. Different services charge you in different ways. All right, scroll down. Identify technical resources and support options. AWS do have some options for support, various different levels depending on the size of your organization and how much budget you have for support. And you need to understand those different plans and what's included. And also the various resources that are available for support as well. Now, the last one here is the appendix. Okay, there's a couple of appendices, but this first one is the important one. So what it does is it highlights the technologies and concepts that might appear on the exam. Okay, so quite a few here. I'm not going to go through all of those. Those are the various different sort of categories, if you like. And then it goes into a bit more detail on the services and features. Now, there are quite a lot of services that you need to know for this exam. The good news is you don't need to know them to a very detailed level. It's often, depending on the service, and we'll make sure we highlight that in our training courses, but depending on the service, in some cases, just knowing what it is and what it does is enough. In other cases, you do need to know a little bit more. So you can see the different categories here and what services might actually appear on the exam. For example, in the analytics case here, there's quite a few of services here that weren't in the previous exam. So those are new additions. Application integration, don't think that's changed. Business applications, Amazon Connect was definitely in the exam before. Cloud financial management, pretty much the same. Compute, well, local zones and wavelength zones, those are probably a newer addition to the exam. Containers, we've got EKS now, as well as ECS and ECR. In customer engagement, some of these are new as well, like AWS IQ. For databases, pretty much the same, except maybe MemoryDB for Redis. I think that's a new addition. Developer tools, you don't have to know how to develop or anything like that. Don't worry for the exam, but you do need to understand what these different developer tools are for, what they're used for. End user computing is there. So we've got a couple of services here, which I do think that they were appearing in some questions in the exam before. Front end web and mobile, we've got a couple there. Internet of Things, that was already in the exam. Machine learning was definitely already in the exam. And I think that list of services is pretty much the same as it was before. We've then got management and governance. There's a couple of new services in here. As you can see, it's quite a lot of services. So you do need to know a little bit about a lot of services to pass this exam. Migration and transfer, these are services that are used for migrating applications from on-premises into the cloud, or maybe between clouds or within the cloud, and transferring data as well. We've then got networking and content delivery, pretty much the same as the last exam. Security, identity and compliance, it's a long list here, and there are a few new additions. And then we've got serverless, which is unchanged. Storage, I think, is pretty much unchanged from the last exam, though FSx might include some of the additional options that you have with that have been released over the last couple of years. Okay, it does then give you some outer scope services as well, so you shouldn't find these types of services appearing in the exam. If you do, it could be because they're a distractor. They're an incorrect answer. They're not actually in scope knowledge. I always say to students, just understand each service on AWS. There are a lot of them, but just spend a bit of time, even if it takes a couple of hours, just understand at a very high level what each service does. And that's really going to help you in the exam. Okay, lastly here, there is a comparison of the CLF C01 to C02. So if you have already been studying for the C01, that might be something to review. Again, you can just search for the CLF-C02 exam guide. AWS will show you the link. And then you can have a look at this and try and understand the differences between the two exams if you feel you just need to close some gaps in your knowledge. Okay, so that's it. Now, you know, sometimes the exams do include a whole bunch of new services. It doesn't mean that they're going to get that much harder necessarily. I usually find they don't get harder. However, there's just a bit more knowledge that you need to pick up. The level of difficulty should be around about the same. So just make sure that in your studies you do cover off those additional services and you'll be good to go.